What is happening, ladies and gentlemen? I have many faults. One of them is not speaking Italian. I'm very sorry. I am very grateful and honored to be here, invited by Professor Brunazzo, and would be very, very pleased to share some views on Ukraine, Russia, EU crisis. Zygmunt Bauman proposed a notion of interregnum, so-called interregnum. He elaborated on that about 2 years ago, and was recently in the interview with one of your colleagues, Professor Della Sala from the Sociology Department, and also he was here invited by Professor Brunazzo in last October. And in a nutshell, what Zygmunt Bauman claims is that we are in the middle of a huge socio-economic, political, technological, and cultural tectonic shifts, in which old paradigms are not working, and we don't know yet what the new paradigms will be dominating the global development. So, in other words, we know the contours of the future, but we, without details as for what this future entails. In one word, Zygmunt says, my old mentor, we are in the interregnum. I would like to propose in the remaining 10 minutes, or 12 minutes with your permission, 5 hypotheses. And do not worry, each hypothesis I will elaborate for no more than 2 minutes. I would like to correct. Zygmunt Bauman's thesis by proposing that Ukrainian-Russian crisis added to our knowledge so significantly that we now know more than we don't. So at least we know what we don't know. My first hypothesis is the following. I will call it, situation is excellent but not hopeless. That is my first thesis. Here I would like to say that the main point is that we can expect the very long rift between Russia and European Union, between Russia and the United States, and it will be, and the gap is so deep that many of my American colleagues are not counting on the current sanctions, but they are thinking how to change the behavior of the Russian elite in the longer terms until and believing that nothing significant will happen until the next elections. So the point is that the situation is excellent but not hopeless, in a sense that we cannot do too much right now, but not hopeless in a sense that the learning process by the Russian elite should take place within next 3, 4, 5 years. So until the next election, the momentum will grow to reevaluate Russian behavior themselves. The second thesis is, I call it, two-headed eagle thesis. As you know, Russian national symbol is an eagle with two heads. One is looking at the west, north, and the other half of the head is looking at south, southeast. And here is the thesis. So far, Russia was very much Western-oriented, both culturally and economically. It was oriented to the extent that 40% of the Russian export and about 60% of the Russian import comes from EU. By comparison, Russia exported 4% to Russia, and both from Russia exported 4% of the goods and natural resources to China, and both from China only 8% of its total import. Now it's time to change. I see this coming, and in the many forms, one of these is to sign the so-called partnership, strategic which will entail not only the natural resources, but also allowing China to participate in the Russian Led Custom Union and eventually in the Central Asian Union. Also, China promised, informally so far, promised to allow Russia to participate in its new hyperlight project of the new Silk Road, linking China with India, Pakistan, Central Asia, and Russia. So, in this sense, Russia is shifting to the east, and not only in the trade and investment, but also culturally. Russia claims that it's no longer a European country. Russia claims that they have own values and they have own perspective of things. And if this is not a European perspective, sorry for Europe, not for Russia. I met Putin last year, and he already in September last year elaborated this this notion of being no longer a European. Third hypothesis, I will call it 24/7 legitimacy shock. And this thesis is, in a nutshell, that it's no longer enough. This is no longer a guarantee to rule, having democratic elections as the basic legitimacy. New rulers all over the year, all over the world, as it has happened in Ukraine, must secure their legitimacy 24/7 per day for 360 days. Otherwise, they risk losing political support and losing political power. Mind you, EU and US supported regime change of the legitimately selected president. You like it or not, EU and US, Canada as well, where I am living, also supported fiercely minor overthrow of the legitimately elected president. This is a paradigm change. This paradigm change in which we will be living for the long term. Fourth hypothesis is the so-called Cassius Clay double guard sovereignty thesis. Cassius Clay, as you know, the famous American boxer, developed this heavy two-guarded defense system. And I believe that we are in the process of states being able of guarding this sovereignty also 24 hours a day. International law and international institutions are not enough to guard the sovereignty. The notion of the sovereignty is dramatically changing. If you are not able to guarantee your own sovereignty, you will lose part of the sovereignty or all of the sovereignty. Crimea is the case. But also Kosovo is the case. But also Libya is the case. But also Syria is the case. But also many other countries, from Mauritania to Somalia, is the case. So Ukraine tells us a big story. Guard your sovereignty, otherwise you will lose it. And norms and values are not enough to guard the sovereignty. This must be something more than that. It should be a real power behind it. Not only that, we are in the new paradigm in which the facts are creating international law. International law no longer creates the reality. Facts create international law. Look at Abkhazia, Northern Ossetia, now Crimea. So, the system based on norms, which we treasure so much in Europe, are being successfully challenged by the new norms based on facts and different perception of the reality, or even, like in the case of Crimea, creating a new reality. Hypothesis number five. There are actually two of them combined. One is so-called reality check, or I would like them to call it reality check hypothesis. And combined with the last one, which is democratic paradox thesis. Reality check hypothesis propose that large units like European Union or the large states can barely extend their policies beyond its own borders. And acting internationally with the sense of ability, with the sense of might, with the sense of having high capacity to make a change, those countries, like European Union at the moment, are creating more anarchy and more destabilization. They are creating more damage than good. European Union created a huge damage so far in Ukraine. This is almost criminal. What they have done, like Mr. Kwaśniewski and his Swedish colleague promised Ukraine that everything will be fine, just sign the document. Where are the money? Where are the troops? Where are the oil and gas? From where? From Slovakia? The reality check is really important. Do not make any promises if you don't have capacity to deliver. Otherwise, you are creating more anarchy and drama. My colleagues in Ukraine are asking me every day what Europe will do for us. And I am saying the same as Europe did for Turkey. Wait. Wait 12 years and organize yourself. And also there is a democratic paradox hypothesis in the nutshell is that if you are exporting democracy to the country which have this different culture, political culture, different societal structure and different economy, you are creating the asymmetric logic, you are imposing something that you know where you don't know how it will work. Therefore, strong democratic process combined with weak institutions, like in Ukraine, and with weak economy, or very weak economy, like in Ukraine, will create more chaos. It's the perfect solution for disaster. In conclusion, I think that Ukraine gave us a lot to think about. I think that the spy hypothesis are the beginning of the process of rethinking the paradigms or new paradigms in international relations. And I think that Zygmunt Bauman's thesis about the interregnum can be corrected by saying that there's no more interregnum. We know, but we are unable simply to take political decisions and to reconsider our actions. I'm most grateful for your